Lubomir Georgiev's classic suite is composed in the form of a Baroque solo suite. After the pattern of J.S. Bach, the work opens with a prelude. Followed by an allemande, a courant, a sarabande. Finally, a gigue. The optional da capo movement found in many of Bach's suites is not included in this work. However, there are other ties to Bach cello suites, number 2 in D minor, BWV 1008, and number 5 in C minor, BWV 1011 in particular. This video will examine the prelude to Georgiev's suite. The sheet music you will see is held in the Martha Blakeney Hodges Special Collections at the University of North Carolina, Greensboro. The prelude's first discernible connection to Bach is the reference to the sarabande of the D minor suite in the opening measure, though in 4-4 time, the reference is unmistakable. Following the first measure, the prelude lands abruptly on a D-flat major triad, averting the expectation of D minor. From this point forward, the movement shifts to a post-functional tonality idiom. D remains a structural-centric pitch class, with the first fermata suggesting an authentic cadence in D. However, the heavily triadic intervening passage does not lead to the cadence through functional tonal progressions. As mentioned previously, this movement shares features with Bach's cello suite in C minor. Namely, its prelude is the only one of the six cello suites followed by a fugue. The fermata that precedes Georgiev's fugue is reminiscent of a half cadence in D leading into the fugue. To define our terms, a fugue is a polyphonic work, with a subject highlighted here in yellow, that is traditionally heard in different keys, and one or more counter-subjects with independent rhythms. This particular fugue is a three-voice fugue, meaning that up to three independent musical lines are discernible at any given time. There are two counter subjects played concurrently with the subject, highlighted in red and pink, respectively. Georgiev masterfully distinguishes the subject from all other parts by having it played on a single string every time it is heard, with only one exception. The fugue lacks any sense of pitch centricity on D until the coda, where the quotation of the Bach sarabande returns. The three-voice fugue is instead organized around set classes. For those who are unfamiliar with set theory, a set class is an unordered collection of pitch classes in normal order, from the smallest to the largest interval in a single direction. Let's take the first three notes, C-sharp, D-sharp, and E, as an example. In this case, going backwards through these notes gives normal order, E to D sharp being the smallest interval. We will assign E a number 0 as the starting pitch class. D sharp will be 1 because it is 1 half step from E, and C sharp will be 3 because it is 3 half steps from E. Thus, this set class is called 0-1-3. Out of all the possible sets on the first line, the two that occur most frequently are 0-1-3 and 0-3-7. 0-3-7 is notable because it sounds either as a major or a minor triad. A minor triad if the intervals begin with the bottom note in root position, and a major triad when starting with the top note in root position. With these two sets, and the occasional 0-2-4, we can see how nearly every pitch in the first subject and answer were generated. These set classes permeate the fugue, but there are other important characteristics that hold the fugue together as well. This fugue is atonal and uses the 12 chromatic pitch classes to highlight significant structural events. The circled notes represent the first time a pitch is heard in the work. The 12th tone, B, is sounded for the first time in the second countersubject at the end of the fugue's exposition when all three voices have entered. We can also trace the use of the 12 tones through the subject and countersubjects individually. Countersubject 2 uses only 8 pitch classes. Both countersubject 1 and the subject itself reach all 12 chromatic tones, and that at another significant formal spot, the return, the final time the subject is heard in the fugue. Let's now listen to this prelude in its entirety. Several of the musical features will continue to be highlighted on the score for you to follow along with. If you have any comments, suggestions, or questions, please feel free to leave them in the comments below.
Thank you.